Hello and welcome to Sunday Online from Christchurch St. James, Etobicoke in West Toronto. We continue to gather like this in order to connect with our friends who we normally would see sitting right here, but not quite as frequent as in the past, not as many people as in the past. But online, yes, many people, including, thankfully, as well, many people we've never actually met face-to-face, but we've come to know and appreciate online from all across the country and beyond. And I'll just say that this last week, no exception, people very kindly getting in touch with us with their questions, with their concerns, with their prayer request, sharing some of their burdens, and expressing ways that maybe we could help. So we want to thank you, and we want to really thank God for every opportunity to be there for one another. Amen? So we're going to gather. We've been meeting around the Gospel of John for a number of weeks, number of months, actually. And we've been walking through this pretty much. It's like a portrait, if you like, of Jesus. It's in the fourth book in the New Testament called John. If you don't have one, by the way, we've got a bundle, and I'd be delighted to pop one of these, maybe this one actually, in the mail to you. If you haven't got a New Testament or a Gospel of John, please just contact us. Our information's at the end of the little video as to how to get a hold of us, and we will promptly pop this in the mail to you at no expense to you at all. All right? So we're going to pray, we're going to read, we're going to reflect, and probably wrap up with a little song as well, okay? So let's pray. So Father, I want to thank you for this moment. We're invited to be still and know that you are God. You are exactly who you say you are. You are present. You are powerful. And yet you are ever so personal. And I pray now, Lord, for all those who are taking the time to be with us, for an awareness of your presence right where everyone is sitting or standing, a new appreciation of your power, that when things look bleak and impossible, they're not, because of who you are, and a great gratitude because of how very personal you are. I ask all these things in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, if you happen to have a Bible with you, turn please to John chapter 12. And just as you're doing that, a little rehash, if you like, from where we left off last week, what had happened in John chapter 11. There was a man whose name was Lazarus, and Lazarus died. Jesus raised Lazarus from the dead. People's response to that, understandably, amazement, wonder, believing in him. How could you not believe in him when you saw a man who was dead and is now alive? How could you not believe? So many believed in Jesus. We read at the end of chapter 11, but also other people, for whatever reason, just reported this to the authorities about Jesus. And then we also read that the authorities were extremely upset because this threatened their security, their position, their status. And from that time on, if you saw Jesus, you were obligated to report that to the authorities. In other words, Jesus was a wanted man. If they put posters up in those days in the post office, his picture would have been on it. So Jesus was, for all intents and purposes, in the eyes of the authorities, an outlaw who had to be captured, who had to be stopped. And that was it. No more questions. That's where we left off last week, chapter 12. 6 days before the Passover celebration began, Jesus arrived in Bethany, the home of Lazarus, the man he had raised from the dead. A dinner was prepared in Jesus' honor. And Martha served, and Lazarus was among those who ate with him. Okay, we'll stop there for a second. 6 days before the Passover. 6 days before this amazing festival, celebration, people looking back to a time when they were in captivity in Egypt, and they were instructed to sacrifice a lamb and to smear the blood of the lamb on their doorpost. And so they would be protected during a time of great trial in Egypt, and their children would be protected. They would be saved, if you like, from death. And yet, 6 days before that celebration, we see Jesus again coming to Bethany. Jesus, who John the Baptist had referred to at the very beginning of his ministry as the Lamb of God, who takes away the sin of the world. Jesus, the ultimate Passover, the one who saves us from death, whose blood was shed for us and saves us from all that would want to rob us of life forever. Jesus saves us, the Lamb of God. We see Jesus now arriving at Bethany, and it's interesting, where does he go? He goes right back to that very same house of the family, Mary, Martha, and Lazarus, the man that he had raised from the dead. And we see him sitting with his friends around a meal table. I mean, the first thing that really strikes us here, isn't it, is the courage of Jesus. This is a wanted man. People are looking for this man. If anyone sees this man, they have to report this man. And yet Jesus, he's not hiding. He's gone right back to where this trouble was sparked, right back to Bethany. People are determined to hunt him down. And yet Jesus is there again with the very man that he raised from the dead. And what is he doing with this man? He's enjoying a meal with this man. He's relaxing with this man. He's enjoying his company. And Lazarus is enjoying his company. If anything says courage, it is this picture right here in the beginning of John chapter 12. And you can imagine the atmosphere, can't you? I mean, again, the word is out. If you see Jesus, you have to report him. But do we detect any apprehension in his host? Do we see anyone calling 911? No, not at all. In fact, by the few words that are written here, we see gratitude. We see happiness. We see joy. We see camaraderie. We see devotion. And Jesus, knowing full well what was on his horizon, he doesn't allow any of that to rob him of this moment with his friends. It's a wonderful picture. A dinner was prepared in Jesus' honor, Martha served, and Lazarus was among those who ate with him. And we can also imagine, can't we, his disciples who are there as well, and they're most likely glancing over, still in stunned misbelief, if you like. I mean, there's Lazarus. He was dead. And here he is sitting, having a meal with Jesus. Days earlier, he was gone. But here he is, alive, happy, and hungry. I mean, it seems the atmosphere could not help but be one of joy and celebration. I'm just trying to imagine what it would be like if a loved one of mine, a loved one of yours, was raised from the dead, and you're having a meal with that loved one in the presence of Jesus. And I can't help but imagine also what was streaming through the mind of Lazarus as he reclined at table with Jesus and with the guest. I mean, would he ever get over it? Do you think so? I don't think so. I mean, Lazarus, I was dead. Yet here I am with Jesus, looking forward to whatever is planned for dessert. I mean, the picture does remind us, doesn't it, deeply, that we too were once dead in our sin. There was no sign of hope for us before Jesus showed up. Jesus called Lazarus by name and raised him up. Jesus has called you and me by name and brought us into a new life. The old has passed away. Behold, all has become new. And he's called us by name to enjoy his company, his fellowship. You remember that very well-known verse, Revelation 3:20. When we read these words, Jesus is speaking, "Behold," or "Listen, look, I am standing at the door," right? "And I'm knocking. If you will hear my voice and open the door," what does he say? "I will come in." And what will I do? Jesus says, "And I will sup with, I will eat with you and you with me. I will enjoy your friendship, your fellowship. All will be forgiven. All will be forgotten. A new life has begun." Well, now Lazarus, he's not the only one present. Of course, we know that. We're introduced again to Martha. Martha, the first one to hear these words from Jesus, "I am the resurrection and the life. The one who believes in me will never die." Right? I mean, and what do we see Martha doing? What Martha always does, but so much differently now. She's serving. And she's serving as a demonstration of her love and her loyalty and her faith and her gratitude. I mean, this speaks volumes, I believe, to many of us, if not to all of us. I mean, people may sometimes wish and wonder if they could do something kind of monumental for Jesus. You know, if only I could preach like Billy Graham did. If only I could travel with the good news like St. Paul did. If only I could care for people the way Mother Teresa did. If only I could advocate for righteousness like a Desmond Tutu did. But there's no need to contemplate any if onlys. It's not about what I can't do. It is about what I can do. And with Martha as an example, can I provide a meal for somebody in need? Somebody who's lonely, somebody who's struggling, somebody who could use a little bit of encouragement? Could I bake or take cookies or muffins or a pie to a neighbor? Could I pitch in at a local food bank? Could I help with Meals on Wheels? Could I volunteer at a shelter or Out of the Cold program or Inner City Mission? I mean, in our own church setting here, we're looking at launching a group of men and women to offer their skills in carpentry and plumbing and electrical, just to be of service to other people. In our own little church here, every 2 weeks, about a dozen women make muffins and sandwiches, etc., and they're all taken down to an inner city ministry known as the Dale, as an expression of love. Whatever you do, we read, do all in the name of the Lord Jesus. Whatever it is, it may seem so small and insignificant, but it's not. Any more than what Martha is doing here is insignificant. It's not. She's serving Jesus as an expression of her love for Jesus. We also, though, see somebody else here. Verse 3, then Mary took a 12-ounce jar of expensive perfume made from the essence of nard, and she anointed Jesus' feet with it, wiping his feet with her hair, and the house was filled with the fragrance. So we saw Lazarus, we saw Martha, and now again we see Mary. And this lady simply delights to be in the presence of Jesus. Every time we see her, she's just in the presence of Jesus at his feet, listening to him as he teaches. The last time we saw her, she was weeping before Jesus because her brother had died. And now we see her holding nothing back at all in a way to express in worship, if you like, her love for Jesus. Sometimes words just don't cut it, right? Sometimes words fall short. I know I feel that way frequently when I try to find ways to express my gratitude to God. For Mary, with the shadow of the cross looming over Jesus, we see her again falling at his feet. Nothing could be too good or too great to offer to him. So we see this extravagant outpouring of adoration, which is what true worship is meant to be, right? She's unrestrained. And it doesn't matter what others think, because others will think something different, at least somebody will. And she throws caution to the wind. And in fact, in the same story in Mark's account, we read that Mary, she couldn't wait for the contents of this jar to drip out slowly. So she breaks the jar, this beautiful bottle, and she pours the contents over the feet of Jesus, lost in wonder, love, and praise. Again, oh, for the world to have many more people like Mary, where worship is not routine, where it's not just about words, where it's not going through the motions, but where it's actual, a genuine love being expressed, like a beautiful fragrance. And all those present can appreciate and benefit by that fragrance. So Lazarus, yep, wow. Martha, good on you, good on you. Mary, yes, so good. But those aren't the only ones present. Look at verse 4. But Judas Iscariot, the disciple who would soon betray Jesus, said, "That perfume was worth a year's wages. It should have been sold and the money given to the poor." Not that he cared for the poor. He was a thief. And since he was in charge of the disciples' money, he often stole some for himself. I mean, what a contrast here, right? It's horrible. I mean, here is somebody, this is what's really upsetting. Here is somebody who, in Mary, who simply wanted to find a way to express uncalculated love and generosity to the one who brought her brother back from the dead. And so she's attached to him. But here's somebody else who is a disciple of Jesus, who's followed Jesus for 3 years. And he hurls these abusive words at her. And it's startling. And what comes to my mind right away, sadly, is that Mary is not the only follower of Jesus who has been hurt by someone in authority in a church setting, or offended by a congregation in any way. I would just say, if you've ever been hurt by someone in authority in the church, number one, you are in the very best of company. Mary knows exactly what that feels like. Judas has spent 3 years following Jesus, but he seems to be so far from all one would imagine a follower of Jesus should be like. Now, it's really important also to note this, and this might be helpful to somebody. Judas was not speaking on behalf of Jesus here. He was not representing Jesus here. This man was flawed. This man was full of contradiction. This man, as we read after that, was his prime concern was money, not miracle. For him, it was about pennies, not people. So when attacked in such a way, it is very helpful to consider the source. There will always be some who are quick to criticize and quick to condemn. But what really matters most here is not what others might think about you. What really matters most here is what Jesus thinks about you. And look what Jesus does here. I love, this is one of my favorite parts. Verse 7, Jesus replies, and he's speaking to Judas here. "Leave her alone. She did this in preparation for my burial. You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me. Leave her alone." I love that about Jesus. The way he just stands up for this lady. Defends this lady. He dives in. "Back off, Judas. Leave her alone, Judas. Shut it, Judas," right? I remember that time when parents brought their little ones to Jesus. And the disciples of Jesus said, "No, no, no, go away, don't bother Jesus with your kids." And what did Jesus say? "Hey, stop it. Let those little ones come to me. For such is the kingdom of heaven." Jesus turned that opportunity into a teaching opportunity. He scolded the disciples and he taught them that we must become like little children, have a simple faith of a child in order to know what it means to belong to the kingdom of God. And likewise here, Jesus doesn't just come to Mary's defense, but he makes it a teaching moment for those who are nearest to him. "You will always have the poor among you, but you will not always have me." Now that might confuse somebody, but here's what he's getting at. Just doing good things minus devotion to Jesus is not enough. If social service isn't an outflow of genuine love, well, Paul talks to us about that in 1 Corinthians 13. Even if I give my body to be burned and, you know, sacrifice everything I have and haven't got love, he says it's nothing. It's nothing. It's absolutely nothing. So Jesus, what he's getting at here is that personal devotion to him is number one priority. The more we love Jesus, here's the way it works. The more we love Jesus, the more we'll love people. Because what matters to Jesus will matter to us. What matters to Jesus? People matter to Jesus. So what will matter to us? People will matter to us. The more we love Jesus, the more we're in tune with Jesus, the more we will be like Jesus. Isn't that something? All the more reason to learn what it means to love God with all our heart and all our soul and all our mind and all our strength. And as a result of that, we then begin to learn what it means to love our neighbor as ourselves. We'll be eager, if you like, to break that alabaster jar and to pour it all out in serving others by honoring Jesus. Amen? A final few words, verses 9 to 11. When all the people heard of Jesus' arrival, they flocked to see him and also to see Lazarus, the man Jesus had raised from the dead. And then the leading priest decided to kill Lazarus, for it was because of him that many of the people had deserted them and believed in Jesus. Oh my, this is an incredible section. I'm not going to do it justice, but I'll give it a shot. Here is a take home for us. Verse 9. When all the people heard of Jesus' arrival, they flocked to see him and also to see Lazarus, the man Jesus had raised from the dead. A good way to pray, Lord, may I become as interesting as Lazarus. In other words, may my faith be attractive to people. May the way I live my faith be fascinating to people. May it cause people to ask good questions about life, about God, about the possibility, the difference that Jesus can make. All right, number 2, verse 10. Then the leading priests decided to kill Lazarus too. Mercy. Okay, well, how do you use that one to pray? Lord, may I be willing to live a dangerous faith, one where there's no question as to where I stand with Jesus, even if it isn't always popular, even if it isn't always appreciated, even if it feels risky at times. Because Lazarus didn't hide. And number 3, verse 11. It was because of Lazarus that many of the people had deserted them, the religious leaders, and believed in Jesus. Because of Lazarus. And so I pray, Lord, may I become as fruitful as Lazarus, that how I live my faith will cause others to embrace Christ too. Yeah, so I put my Bible down and say, okay, Bruce, what's the take home? Well, I think it's kind of obvious. Number 1, we are all invited, aren't we, to come around that table. We saw a table in the beginning here, a meal table with Jesus. We're all invited to come around that table. There's a place for you at that table. As many as received him, he gave them the power to become the children of God, even to those who believed on his name. We're all invited. The door is there. He's at the door. He's knocking. If we open it up, he will sup with us and we will sup with him. We're all invited. No exceptions, no exclusions. You are invited. Number two, and as people who are loved by Jesus, we are encouraged, like with Mary and Martha, to offer our very best to serve him. A wonderful verse from Romans chapter 12, verse 1 and 2. I beseech you, therefore, brothers and sisters, by the mercy of God, that you present your bodies as a living sacrifice unto God, which is your reasonable worship. Interesting, eh? We're invited to present all we are to Jesus as an act of worship. How? It's not just what we say, it's how we live. That's worship. And number three, we are inspired, aren't we? Perhaps wild in the eyes of some people, to express our love for Jesus, even at the risk, like Mary experienced, of being criticized by those who may be occupied, sadly, with the things of this world. Listen to these words from Psalm 95. Come, let's sing to the Lord. Let's shout joyfully to the rock of our salvation. Let's come to him with thanksgiving. Let's sing psalms of praise to him. For the Lord is a great God, a great king above all gods. He holds in his hand the depths of the earth and the mightiest mountains. The sea belongs to him. He made it. His hands formed the dry land too. So come, let's worship and bow down and kneel before the Lord our Maker. For he is our God, and we are the people he watches over, the flock under his care. Wow. Okay. A song that comes to mind right away, and I know that it might be a bit familiar because it's been sung more than once with the online. I think I first heard it about 45 years ago. So it's not hot off the press, but it's an expression of worship. Here we are in your presence, lifting holy hands to you. Here we are, praising Jesus for the things he's brought us through. I don't have the words to tell you how I feel. I just don't know what I can say. I'm not worthy to speak your holy name, yet you tell me you love me just the same. Here we are in your presence, lifting holy hands to you. Here we are, praising Jesus for the things he's brought us through. I never thought it would be this way. I never thought I'd be the one. Yet you found me dying in my sin, and you looked at me and loved and took me in. Here we are in your presence,
lifting holy hands to you. Here we are, praising Jesus for the things he's brought us through. For the things he's brought us through.
Yeah. Maybe that's an expression of what's on your heart today in gratitude for all he's done for you. And if this is all brand new to you, please know that you are not meant to be on the outside looking in. You are welcome to come inside. If you've been seeking, it's time to find. You look for him. You draw close to him, he draws near to you. You take one step toward him, he'll take two steps towards you. That's just the way God, he loves you. He loves you. He does not want you to miss out. He wants you to know what it means to belong, to be loved by him, to experience a love that will literally change who you are and how you do life, how you see life. All of life, because he's the author of life, and he gave his life for you so you could have this life. And not just right here in the moment, but life forever in the presence of God. Amazing stuff. Overwhelming. Again, words don't come close. So I'll just have a quick prayer and thank you. So Father, thank you for this moment. Thank you for all those who have taken the time to be with us today in this way. And thank you for this incredible message of new life and the opportunity to express our gratitude in countless ways by serving others. In Jesus' name, amen. Until next time.